All from one family on stage. Their first gig, the Corrs.
It didn't go in that we could actually be meeting our producer or that this could be a major record deal for us.
If you feel the emotion in every song, you give across the emotion of the song.
You have been a wonderful audience and we will remember this. We will be back.
When you're put in a situation where you have to perform, where you have to deliver, no matter what, if something happens.
That's why we're doing it. We're doing it because we love it.
Hi, this is Simon Phillips. I play drums on Toss the Feathers and had a wonderful time doing it. You are listening to CorrsCast.
Hi, welcome. This is a new venture to find a piece of the podcast world where the Corrs are celebrated, specifically focusing on their first album, Forgiven, Not Forgotten. My name's Simon. I'm your host for the time being. No doubt, in future episodes, we will have guest hosts, others to come on and discuss from the fan community, and generally celebrate and explore the creation of the first album to begin with. And then let's see where the world takes us from there. Fandom is a big place. There is a lot of people. I guess I should start with explaining how this project came about. How do I suddenly find myself creating a podcast for the Corrs? I guess it was late 2019. I was listening to a lot of podcasts, very inspired by podcasts such as JC'sMusicology, listening to him break down artists I've loved for decades, their music, and exploring demo versions, etc. Was just incredibly inspiring. It was like listening to tracks I'd heard for years for the first time all over again. And then realizing maybe I could do a tenth of that. Maybe I could do 5% of that when it comes to another band I love, which was the Corrs. Being the year it was coming up to 25 years since the first Corrs album was released. 25 years I thought was a good milestone to maybe explore that album. And then either in my foolishness or wisdom, while lockdown had started, I decided to proactively try and reach out to everybody I could involved in the creation of the album to see if they wished to talk about their experiences 25 years on, what the album meant to them, what it was like being in the studio, and the development of the sound that we know to be Forgiven Not Forgotten now. To my surprise, during lockdown, with people having more time on their hands than they otherwise may have found themselves with, they replied with yes, a resounding yes. Every single person I've asked so far to record a discussion regarding the album and their work on it has been more than kind and more than glad to discuss and explore and sit patiently through my many questions. The outcome of that has been many short as well as long recordings regarding the album's production, recording, and eventual release. Hopefully this will be appreciated by the fan community, whom I owe a huge debt to. Many years of going to many live gigs and discussions on forums, etc., have certainly kept my fandom alive, especially when the band has gone into hiatus so that they can have their own families and have their own lives apart from music. I'll kick things off with the first interview, which was with Simon Phillips, who lent his amazing drumming skills to a number of tracks, which we get to discuss together in this next recording. I hope you enjoy. I guess to start things off, how did you get chosen for this part and why were you chosen for this?
I mean, at that stage, it's just another session, but with one of my favorite engineers, which is great. And I hadn't worked with David before, but I'd met him. So yeah, it was a question of, right, we got some sounds and then I met the Corrs. Obviously I figured out they were Irish. And I went, oh, great. Oh, yeah, that's kind of fun, you know. And then I was kind of, okay, well, this will be interesting, you know. You know, I remember getting, you know, as you normally do, get sounds and grab a coffee and go into the control room and listen to the track. So, you know, after saying all the hellos and the introductions, it was like, okay, well, here's the track, you know.
Can you remember what it was like listening to that track? How was it presented to you in the studio?
Basically from the multi-track that they were working on. I'm not sure if it had a drum track on it, like a program drum track, or whether it was just with a click. But I remember hearing the music and went, oh, this sounds great. Because I love Irish folk music. I like and mostly Celtic, you know, folk music. Mm. I think it's just absolutely gorgeous. And I could hear the influences in it and how it had been arranged. And I thought, oh, this is going to be perfect to play, because it was just really fun. It was beautiful, beautiful piece of music, you know? And I was like, wow, okay, right, you know? And I think I might have written, I think I wrote a very quick chart out, just because the chart helps you do it quickly. I'm a real believer in first or second takes. I love the energy and the intuition, depending on the people you're working with, the producer or the artist. You know, some can be, you can get a song done in just one or two takes, or you could be there all day. You know, it's just one of those things. But so that's why I always do a quick chart. And then I think I went out and did one pass, probably came in to have a listen just to make sure everything was sounding good. But I don't remember. I have to admit, I actually don't remember how many takes I did, but I don't think it was many at all. And then I think I probably went out again. Maybe I think everybody was happy with the sound of the kit and everything. And then did another take. And I think I did two punches, which means just punching in for a couple of bars and punching out. There were some interesting hits in the middle of the song.
Get in and out before the lick. We'll rehearse the punch one time.
Yeah.
Oh, the breakdown in the middle is just, yeah, you were saying about one or two takes and giving that first time energy to it. It definitely comes across in the recording. I mean, wow.
Yeah.
There's a reason the band's then taken that song as their finale song after their encore.
Yeah.
You know, and Caroline's now made her own version of that break in the middle to be able to achieve it.
Great. Because I was very proud of that session. It was, like I said, it was one of the tracks that just felt great. It was at the right tempo, and I was able to find a groove very quickly that worked with it. I mean, I enjoyed it so much. I think I said, right, got any more songs?
Yeah. And of course, leading on from that, you were in to do two songs. You did Toss the Feathers.
Yes.
And then you also did drum inlays for the track I Don't Know.
Ah, okay. I remember doing a second song, but I'm not sure if that was used.
It wasn't used in the final album, no.
No.
It wasn't used in the final album. Probably the first time you've heard that in 25 years.
Exactly. Yeah.
Well, it's good to be able to bring that back to you. It's nice.
I remember having a really lovely day with everybody. It was fantastic. We ordered some food. I remember that we had some Chinese or Thai food, I think. And it was great. It was a really lovely afternoon. It really was. It was really fun. Really sweet. Yeah. I remember, no, I was really impressed with all of them. I mean, just the music, you know, she sounded great on that other track, which is probably the only other track I heard.
I've read rumor that David Foster asked for you specifically for that track.
Yeah, he did. Yeah.
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 Why do you think that is? What connection did you have prior to this that would have made him think, I know, I need Simon Phillips on this track?
I think, well, he probably just knew the way I play. He knew that I had just joined Toto. I remember him coming by the studio when we were recording at Capitol. We were recording Tambu at that time.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's, I think that's when I first met him. But I also seem to remember a charity gig at the Hollywood Bowl or the Greek Theatre. I don't remember which one, because I might have done two, you see. I might be getting mixed up. One was Bosnian Aid. It was like a charity gig in aid of the Bosnian refugees or that whole war that was going on at the time. And I know he was performing on that. So, and that could have been 95, could have been 94. So he certainly would have seen me play because he was obviously there, you know, for the whole concert. Yeah. So I'm not really sure, or maybe he knew of my playing way before that. I actually don't know, because I only ever worked with David that one time. Bob was brought in to engineer me. Yeah, because I think they knew it's a very extensive and complicated drum kit. It's not actually, it's actually really easy, but a lot of people, they get a bit frightened. A lot of engineers actually get a bit frightened of it because there's a lot of microphones, you know? And, but Bob has recorded me a few times and he actually knows, actually it's not that difficult, you know, it's actually easy. It's just, you know, it's a lot of mic stands, a lot of mics and a lot of cables. That's really all it is. But if you know how to engineer and how to record, you know, acoustic instruments, I think that's the big issue these days. He got it down beautifully. Yeah, he got a great sound. Mm-hmm. So, and I think David's smart. You know, he said, "I think we need to get someone in who's maybe recorded me before or knows how to deal with this large drum kit." So he got Bob in, and Bob said, "Oh, yeah, no problem." And therefore, the sounds were up in minutes, literally.
Wow.
I mean, as long as it takes to go bing, 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 bing. Right, next one, bing. You know what I mean? It's not rocket science. It's just common sense and good ears and knowing what you're doing. That's all it is.
How did it start? How did drums become your art? Where did it start for you?
Well, my father was a band leader back in, well, actually, he had his first band in 1925. So, and he was very well-known and successful in Britain. So he took the war years away from music. I don't think he did much music during the war. He was very involved in he was in the RAF. So and then after everybody got demobbed, he got back into running his band again. And he became in the 50s like one of the leading UK dance bands at the time.
Wow.
So when I came along in the late 50s, I was exposed to the band rehearsing at our house, you know.
Wow.
So I was surrounded by very shiny brass instruments, you know, tenor, alto, baritone, trumpet, trombone. And then one day he got a new drummer, a young drummer, and he also changed the setup of the way the band set up in the room, the living room at the house. And it just so happened that the drums were the first instrument that I bumped into when I walked in at 3 years old.
Wow.
And I couldn't, that was it. As soon as I saw the guy playing these drums, the pedal, the hi-hat going up and down, the shiny chrome Ludwig snare drum, although I didn't know what it was back then, that was it. And the next, and I was sent off to bed at some point, and I remember sitting up with a couple of books and playing along with the with the band that I could hear there, and that was it.
Wow. There must have been a lot of pride from your father in seeing you kind of take to music.
He wasn't too thrilled about it, actually. He would much rather have preferred me not to be a musician and have a, you know, straight job, safe job. My mom was very into it, though, because she was an amateur musician, played very good piano, played a little bit of drums, and she had done that during the war, too. The Allies were in Europe. She was sent over there. She was in the army and sent over as a, she was a truck driver. And she would go to bars and, you know, clubs over there and sit in with the band, because it was a question of, can anybody play an instrument?
Yeah.
Yeah, I play. Right, come on. Let's, you know what I mean? No, nobody was booking bands back then. I mean, most of the towns were rubble. It's really stunning. Really amazing, you know. So she was very into it, and then, you know, met my dad, and that was it, basically. So she was very encouraging. My dad wasn't, but then he realized that there really was some serious talent there, and then I joined his band when I was 12 years old and went on the road.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, what a life. So you've always known this then? From day one, you've really always known this kind of,
This I was at school with looking at my watch that had years on it, not minutes and hours. In you know, right, I've only got three more years to go. You know, when is this over? When can I get out and, you know, get on the road and start playing and get in the studio?
Wow.
That's what I always wanted to do. Yeah, there was no question about it. But I was extremely lucky to go through life like that, you know, knowing exactly what I wanted to do. Yeah. In fact, funny little story about the Corrs. I took my band on the road a few times in the late 90s. I want to say it's like 97 or 98 or something. And we used to use a bus company over there. I think it was Len Wright. And so when we all flew over from LA and landed in some town and was in a hotel, the bus would then arrive from England into wherever we were, Belgium or Switzerland or Germany, probably Germany. And the bus driver came out. I think his name was Mark, ex-army guy, which a lot of the bus drivers are. And the first thing he said, oh, by the way, the Corrs say hello to you. I just finished a tour with them on this bus.
Wow.
Isn't that funny? And they said, he said, oh, they all say hello and have a great tour and stuff like that. And I went, wow, that's really nice. So, we used their bus after they'd been on tour. It was really sweet. That was a nice, nice little story.
Yeah, it's a nice little tie-in that, you know, that family band, you know, just have the courtesy to at least acknowledge your, you know, your part in their history as well. It's nice.
It was actually really sweet. It was lovely.
Thank you so much for taking the time. It's been a pleasure having you on. It's been, you know, really great to get back to the studio, I guess. Even if it was so long ago, and try and piece together what it was like to be there. And it sounds an amazing experience. Thank you for taking the time. Really means a lot.
Fantastic. Thank you. Very nice to talk to you. Okay, take care. Bye-bye.
Hi, I'm Michael Thompson, and I was able to contribute guitar work to Forgiven Not Forgotten with the Corrs, and it was a great experience, and you are listening to CorrsCast.
The next interview in the series is with the amazing Michael Thompson, who recorded all of the session guitar work for the first album. Our conversation together started with me asking him how he first heard of the band, and more specifically, what he'd heard from David Foster, the producer, who he'd worked alongside on a number of projects.
The first album, definitely, I mean, just the whole story of, I mean, I wasn't there. I had just been in the studio with David, and but they literally came into the control room of the studio and performed a couple of tunes. And he signed them on the spot.
That's what I've heard. Were you there for that? Were you nearby?
No, I had just been there.
Yeah.
I was in New York City, I believe, right?
Correct. And you'd been working with Michael Jackson on History, I believe.
Yeah, I was playing on that song, The Earth Song, with David, you know, the Michael song. And later that day, I believe, is when they came by. We were at Sony in New York, and the day before we did another tune for Babyface did a duet with Lisa Stansfield that we did at the Hit Factory. But no, David told me about it. Man, they came in, they had I guess it was Jim had a guitar, they had the violin, the penny whistle, and they just floored him.
Mm. Something incredibly attractive about that raw talent and harmony from a sibling point of view, as well as a musicianship point of view.
Yeah, I mean, when you can just set up, not even set up, just perform in a control room, it's like, okay, let's see what you got, you know, and then be that together and that much of an appealing kind of thing. And so that whole first album was, I was very impressed with how mapped out it was. I mean, you say there's demos for it and stuff, so I guess, you know, and Jim was really, he was really on top of it. I mean, he liked working with me because I would, I did all the electric stuff and a little bit of the acoustic stuff, but I would work it out so he would do the acoustic stuff, you know, and he had a great feel and a great touch and stuff. But yeah, we had a good little working relationship going there.
It's really interesting because as a fan listening back to the record, the session musicians are, I guess, in a way forgotten about. They just are, until you really dig into, oh, hang on a minute, this was originally performed by somebody else. And then when I'm seeing it live, they're copying the person that originally performed it.
Yeah.
They're taking their own take on it. But that's why it doesn't sound quite like the record. You know, it's just...
Right.
Or at all like it sometimes, complete differences. One instance would be, I've just interviewed Simon Phillips, who did drums on two tracks. He did drums for Toss the Feathers, great trad track. And then he also did the track I Don't Know.
Yeah. I mean, they did those separately from the sessions with David. Maybe that was a song I never even heard. But that's definitely like a synth, you know, that sort of imitating a lead guitar vibe. I'm just wondering who would have played it. But it might have been Jim. Like I said, I never heard David actually, not that he couldn't solo like that, but that wasn't his thing at all. And not, over the years, I never heard him do a synth solo like that. Now, I remember the Toss the Feathers thing and it being pretty intricate, and you know, I had to actually practice whatever the fast little line was in that song. You know, they're all staying at this David's wife Linda had a house in Malibu that was her house, and they would, David's studio, he put his studio in there. And so for about 3 or 4 years before his next Malibu house, he had his studio there, but the Corrs all stayed there with the parents and everything right in that house. So the studio and everything was all self-contained, you know, and I'll never forget driving in, because it was off, it's in Malibu, but it's kind of off the main road. You go in this sort of little country road kind of thing to get to her place. And I'm driving in to go to the session, and Andrea was like, she had like a skimpy something on, and she was just walking down the road, like about, you know, a quarter mile from the house. I didn't know she was who I was going to be working with. And my head was like, what, who is that? You know, like, and then we get back. Then I go to the studio and I'm getting ready and I meet Jim and stuff. And then Andrea comes walking in. I'm like, oh, wow, you were who I just saw. Yeah.
Yeah. So you said that they stayed on property. What were they with their family? Was their mom and dad there then?
Yeah. They were all staying in that house. It was a good little setup, especially to do when you're working on a record every day, you know. And I remember Caroline had like a pad drum set. I mean, they were really working at their instruments and stuff. Like because the studio was in one part of the house, and then, you know, we'd go in the other part of the house, and you know, they'd be practicing. They were really working it. I was very impressed with their musicality and their dedication and stuff. But yeah, that was a good experience. And so I ended up doing a lot of sessions on that record.
I'll probably get back to this in a minute, but I'm interested to see how much of the construction of the tracks, especially from a guitar point of view or rhythm point of view, was your making.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think besides Jim, I was, as far as I know, I was the only guitar player on that record. And like I said, I think maybe for one or two parts, I would get a guitar sound, like an electric guitar sound, and let Jim play it. I mean, I say let Jim play it. He already knew the part and stuff. But just, I remember just really trying to include him on the thing, because, you know, some producers, David Foster being one of them, are known for when they do an album, like when he worked with Chicago and stuff, he just totally brought in his own guys, you know, and the guys in the band, that doesn't go over well, you know. Plus Jim was so great, and he was perfect for doing that with. Like I said, Jim did some nice little acoustic stuff, and one or two little electric things here and there. I mean, David wanted me to play all the electric stuff, but once we had done a number of sessions and I saw how good Jim was and how competent, it's like, you know, he already has this part, why me learn it and play it? He's in the band. So because I work with a few of those things where I'm working with a band, and you always try to, even though you're a session musician coming in to play on the thing, you try to include them, you know. And sometimes it's more just a matter of diplomacy, you know, to you. But in their case, it was like, what am I going to do? Play it better than him? But I had all the sounds and the parts and the electric thing and the vibe going on that. So it was a good working relationship.
Were you presented demo versions of anything where the guitar, the main electric guitar, was filled in with synths and then you played over top?
David had this guy named Simon Franklin that was an English guy who was over here for about 10 or 15 years, and he had a synclav, and that was David's guy. They would construct the tracks. And so I guess they were taking all the elements of the demos and stuff. And Simon was great with sounds, great with putting together tracks. And for all those 90s hits that I did with David, the band was just me and Simon and David doing all the other parts. No real drummer, no real bass player, no, you know, and they were great records, and they had a great sound to them. But I think Jim got so enthralled with working with the synclav, at one point he was saying he wanted to get one and stuff. They were super expensive. They were like $200,000 or something.
Wow.
But pre-Pro Tools and stuff, it was a really cool thing. And then when you had someone who knew, it was basically a keyboard but it had all the samples and everything right in it. And wow. Simon was really quick with drum sounds and great sounds and stuff, so he could put a track together fast. Because David liked to work, fairly quickly and stuff too. And so anyway, I believe that was a lot of the thing. Those two songs that Simon played on, just had to have real drums,
Yeah.
They were like crying out for real drums. But the rest of it, I believe, is just the, the synclav drums. I don't know how much the girls, they were all there, but Jim was like the mastermind of the thing. And David was so, because usually David Foster, he has a vision for the track and he does it the way, I would play my input was my input on most of those records. He very rarely told me what to play or anything. But as far as the vision for the whole track, he's one of those guys. But Jim had it so, David also recognized that Jim was such a talent and he had their music so organized already what they wanted to do, that it was more a matter of just getting it down.
Getting it recorded and down, and then after that, mixing to their heart's content. Yeah.
Right. And then they obviously were doing the girls on maybe Caroline, maybe she did play drum pad stuff on some of those songs. I'm just assuming a lot of it was the sure. synclav drum machine, but she did have that pad kit there, and I believe they did use her on it.
Yeah, because obviously a year before that, before they're even signed, Jim was hiring a top floor bedroom in a house a couple of corners from their family home so that they could make the demos in. And he had, very basic kit for the time and keyboards so that he could program stuff up. And then less than a year later, he's in the studio with David Foster and he got a co-producing credit on that album.
Yeah.
Like, that's mind-blowing.
It really was, and especially then, because David wasn't doing any co-producing with anyone, But he had that much of an input on the thing that you had to call it what it was,
It's wonderful. And I think it's a story that needs to be told and further looked into, because it's just, it's an incredible record and an amazing, it's a kind of like a rags to riches story. It's hi, a couple of girls from school, their older brother, they're messing around with song, they've got great harmony with their singing, they're practicing and really putting in the hard graft to perfect their craft. And then suddenly they're at the door of the biggest pop producer the world had known at that time.
Right.
And then it all just takes off.
Right. I mean, they were so appealing with their talent and their looks and stuff that it was like a no-brainer, When we did that first album, I was thinking, this is some really good stuff. I wonder if, the world is going to pick up on it, and they did. But that was cool. I remember during the recording of that album, because they were in town for I don't know, it seems like it must have been 4 or 6 months, and I played a club gig, just one of my gigs I do every now and then, but I get to really play and solo and stuff. And they came down, I think, like Andrea, Jim, and maybe the other two girls, they all came to this club that I played at, right? And the next day, we had a session with David, and they came in just like raving about the gig, and they said, oh, Michael was brilliant and stuff. And I remember thinking, I've worked with David Foster for, at that point, probably about 7 years or something, and he's never once seen me play in a club. They were reporting to him that I was, burning on my gig, but he hadn't actually seen me. But we had done a bunch of his live gigs together where we were just, backing up artists and stuff. But I thought that was cool. I thought it was cool that they came down, and I thought it was cool that they really liked it too.
It's very down to earth, isn't it? It's that kind of small town feel. It's like, I'm no better than you. We're here to have a good time and appreciate music as well. Why would I not want to hear you play,
Yeah. And they were truly unknown at that point, you know.
Do you know what guitar you used for, or what guitar set?
Oh, I had a bunch of them. Yeah. I had a bunch of them. This guitar, which is it's a Strat, but it's not the Fender. It's this thing. I've had it since 82.
Wow.
That is my kind of hit maker guitar that I definitely know I used that on a bunch of it. But I would have you know, in the 80s when I was struggling to work my way up the studio ladder, I only had this guitar. I think I had one other thing and an amp and a couple of little things, and that grew into this like really huge rig. And so 95 would have been the peak of like refrigerator rack and the whole thing, and that was part of it. It was like, you know, it was expected of a studio guitar player to come in and have all that, and I used it. I mean, I actually used all those sounds, and so they dug that. And
nice.
I think I even turned Jim on to, like, because he wanted to put together a guitar rig, you know, and I helped him, you know, choose some of the stuff for it and stuff.
Yeah, it's definitely has a good selection of guitars when they go live. Huge, huge setup for rigs with multiple guitars.
Yeah. Changes.
It's nice. Really nice. So it's nice to hear where that would have originally started from. It's cool.
Yeah. Very cool. That might have been the inspiration on that.
I've got a version of Someday which doesn't have you playing those riff parts. This version is prior to bringing you in to the studio to put down guitars. So this is entirely just with synths instead of any guitar parts, and then I'll play you the final version as we hear it on the album, so you can see and possibly remember what it was like sitting listening to this in the studio ready to put those guitar parts down 25 years ago.
Yeah I mean, I haven't heard it in years. Sounds so similar to, yeah, that's what I was saying. They had their shit together, man. They had the tunes all that David, I mean, yeah, because I remember him saying about how he didn't change anything on some of those songs, you know, as you see right there with the demo. So you got to cut Jim as a co-producer on the thing for sure. I mean, David added his bits wherever he could, but they were very together.
The song sounds like, it sounds like they were very tight before they even came into the studio.
Yeah.
And then when they were put together, they were like, yeah, that's what we want to achieve.
Yeah.
How long do you think, or do you know, before you were brought in? At what stage were you brought in the project?
It was ongoing. I don't think, it wasn't like they had the whole album mapped out with all the tracks and stuff. I think they were, you know, they got a couple ready for me and I played on them. And then, like, you know, like I said, this guy, Simon Franklin, you know, they'd do a day with him. They'd get another tune or another couple of tunes going. I'd come in, play guitar over the course of a couple of months, probably, you know. So I'm not sure quite how that went, but it was an ongoing, like, I remember just working on the Corrs and not maybe during that time David did, you know, like a Celine song or something like that, but I think he devoted a bunch of time there to doing their record. And since they were staying at the house and stuff, it had to.
Yeah, it's kind of, you're here, you're right here, you're practicing, we might as well, let's do this.
Yeah.
Closer was the next one I've got on the list, was a single as well.
Yeah, I love that tune.
It's beautiful.
I always wondered why she said closer.
Yeah, it's kind of an extended kind of strange
what
vocal,
isn't
it?
What will I see if I look closer?
And I remember asking Andrea about that, and she said, I think something to the effect of it sounded more interesting.
It does. Yeah. I guess it does. And the reason that we're talking about it and wondering about it now, I guess it lends to that intrigue, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, because it was when you work on a song, when I work on a song, I'm hearing it over and over and over for like, you know, hours. And so all the little nuances that the vocal's doing and stuff, I get pretty inside, you know? And I remember that song always, it had that sort of like intrigue of like, why is she saying closer, you know? But yeah, I did end up asking her about it. All those tunes, you know, I don't know the order, but just in a row. And I remember doing like two or three sessions a week, you know, when it was going hot and heavy there. Or maybe I do two sessions and come back the next week and do another two. I mean, like 2 days. The sessions were usually 6 hours, you know. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, each song represents a 3-hour session. And sometimes more than the more guitar heavy tunes, we would a lot of times spend 6 hours on a song. But sort of the studio thing was always like 3 hours per tune kind of thing. But we would go and do it what they call a double session, which would be a 6-hour session. And most, or if not all of the Corrs sessions were always like double sessions, you know, because, and they would, you know, yeah, I didn't see the behind the scene, well, not behind the scenes, but I wouldn't see the work that would go on when I wasn't there, obviously, but I'd show up and they'd have a couple of tracks ready for me to work on, you know? So there was a bunch of work that went into those. That was one of the few, not few, but so many of, especially with David Foster, that the songs we worked on were just like one-off, not one-off, but like, it was just a song. It wasn't a whole album project that we were working on. You know, like with Celine, I would end up playing on a few songs for the record, but they were the hits. David was very hit oriented, and he didn't do a very many. I mean, when I met him in 90 to the present day, he didn't do bands and do albums like that. The Corrs were a real exception to, I mean, in the 80s, you know, there was Chicago and there was the Tubes, and he did work with some bands, but the Corrs were one of the only things. I can't remember another group record like that, or even a whole record like that. David would usually just do the hit, you know?
For this album, the only other one I've got on this list is a B-side that was released on one of their singles. The track's called Rainy Day.
Mm.
Really lovely track. Wow. Really, I'm amazed I didn't hear the album. Let me play you a little bit of it now.
That is me for sure. Because the thing that really let me know is that those notes that start the tune, those harmonics, that's like something I do a lot. And that that's definitely one of my parts. Wow. So that wasn't on the record.
That wasn't on the record. It was a B-side on the Love to Love You single. So wow. It got out, but B-side.
You knew more about it than I did. I just assumed every song I played on made the record. But yeah, that was a good little tune. And I do remember, well, I mean, when I hear that part, that's like the kind of part I do for sure.
Yeah, you it's like, you know, your own children, isn't it? It's you kind of know if it's,
it is. You can hear your baby crying and know it's yours, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool little tune. It wasn't like there were a lot of musicians coming in and out playing on it, like the Wrecking Crew playing on all those hits that we didn't know it was them, kind of thing. Mm. This was just, you know, Simon Franklin, David, Jim, you know, and the girls. But there weren't any outside musicians besides me, you know, that on and Simon Phillips on that couple of tunes. But yeah, you know what? They had real bass. My friend Neil Stubenhaus played on one of the songs. You know, I think literally he came in and did one session because they wanted real bass on that one song. You know, he's been a good friend of mine for a long time. I forgot that he had played on the song. So it was cool. Like I said, I mean, the takeaway from the whole thing was they were so good at what they did and they were so proficient on their instruments. And Jim was so good and had all the parts and wrote all the parts and stuff, that why use an outside person, you know?
Clear cut, very clear cut.
Yeah.
It was great to hear you reminisce for tracks you haven't heard for 20 years.
Yeah.
And still be enthused about them. That's lovely.
Yeah. And like I said, man, I've been, because I have my iPod in shuffle mode when I do my bike ride, and the bike ride is like 2 hours, you know. And I was just recently thinking, God, I need some new music on here because I leave stuff on there forever. That record would be perfect to put on there. I'll relive it and dig those songs all over.
Do enjoy it. Thank you so much for spending the time. It's been great to chat. Thank you for agreeing to come on and keep playing. Your work is amazing.
Thanks.
And so ends the second interview for the CorrsCast and indeed the first episode of the series. Michael Thompson mentioned in the interview that he was friends with Neil Stubenhaus, who played bass, the live bass for Toss the Feathers. I reached out to Neil and he kindly came back to me with a quote that he said I could read out on the show, just to give you some context of what he did and his experience, however brief that may have been. One thing you learn about recording is that some experiences are completely devoid of an experience. David Foster called me to be at Record Plant one morning for an overdub at around 10 a.m. The song turned out to be Toss the Feathers. I did not know the name of the song or the artist prior to arriving, and nobody from the band was there. It was just David, his engineer, and me. By 12 noon, I was finished. I recalled that it was good, but don't remember much else from the session. I heard rumblings later that the group was taking off, and around that time, I heard the track once or twice. I would have loved to have met them, but that never ultimately happened. So a huge thank you to Neil for those brief comments regarding his time in the studio recording for Toss the Feathers. I just want to take a moment to again thank Simon Phillips and Michael Thompson for giving of their time so freely to discuss something that was so long ago. It was great to hear the stories and for them to reminisce what it was like to be in the studio at the time of the album's creation. Thank you also for listening. Please do reach out to me if at all possible, if you've enjoyed the content. If there's something you wanted to discuss in the content, maybe I can have you on the CorrsCast so we can discuss it and others can listen in. Feel free to contact me through, probably easiest is the Instagram page, which is CorrsCast. Again, thank you for listening. Thank you for spending the time. I hope you found this insightful, fun, and I'll see you in the next episode.